ओम अज्ञानतिमिरांधस्य ज्ञानांजनशलाकया चक्षुरुन्मीलितं येन तस्मै श्रीगुरवे नमः। नमः ओं विष्णुपादाय कृष्णप्रेष्ठाय भूतले श्रीमते भक्तिवेदान्तस्वामिन्निति नामिने। नमस्ते सारस्वते देवे गौरवाणी प्रचारिणे निर्विशेष शून्यवादी पाश्चात्यदेशतारिणे। जय श्री कृष्ण चैतन्य प्रभु नित्यानंद श्री अद्वैत गदाधर श्रीवासादि गौर भक्त वृंद। हरे कृष्णा कृष्ण कृष्णा हरे हरे, हरे रामा राम रामा हरे हरे। सो विल कंटिन्यू अवर डिस्कशन अबाउट सैक्रिफाइस इन दी नाइन्थ चैप्टर ऑफ द भगवद गीता। लॉर्ड कृष्णा is explaining pure devotional service. He calls this pure devotional service as Raja Vidya Raja Guhya, the king of all knowledge and the topmost secret or the most confidential knowledge. So in this chapter, Krishna explains something very important about sacrifice. In the 20th verse of this 9th chapter, Lord Krishna says, Traividya mam somapa putapapa yajnair ishtva swargatim prarthayante te punyam asadya surendra lokam ashnanti divyan divideva bhogan. What is the meaning of this verse? The meaning is, those who study the Vedas, particularly the three Vedas, Rig Veda, Yajur Veda and Sama Veda, and drink the Soma juice, seeking the heavenly planets, Swargatim, Prarthayante, they worship Krishna indirectly. They take birth on the planet of Indra, Surendra Lokam, and there they enjoy godly delights, those facilities which normally devatas enjoy. Those people who follow these Vedic directions to perform certain types of sacrifices. So Srila Prabhupada explains, there are people who are great scholars in the Vedas and they do not understand the real purpose of the Vedas, ultimate goal of the Vedas or ultimate purpose of the sacrifices. Krishna declares himself to be the goal of all such Vedic study. Vedaischa sarvair ahameva vedyam. But these official students of the Vedas, they become more interested in offering sacrifices to the devatas according to this Vedic directions for the purpose of enjoying materially in heavenly planets after being elevated to that kingdom of Indra. What happens? They are able to actually purify themselves of the lower qualities of nature, Rajoguna, Tamoguna. And by developing Sattvaguna, they are elevated to the higher planetary systems, including the heavenly planets. But what happens that Krishna describes in the next verse, 21st verse of the 9th chapter, Te tam bhuktva swargalokam vishalam kshine punye martyalokam vishanti. एवं त्रयी धर्मम अनुप्रपन्ना गतागतम काम कामा लबन्ते. The meaning of this verse is, when they have thus enjoyed heavenly sense pleasures, they return to this mortal planet again, this earthly planet. Thus, through the Vedic principles, they achieve only flickering happiness. Certainly, it is a fact that on the higher planets, they have a longer duration of life and better facilities for sense enjoyment, but one is not allowed to stay there forever. As soon as the punya is exhausted, the pious credits, whatever punya they had accrued or accumulated by performing the sacrifices according to the Vedic directions. After that punya is exhausted, they again are sent back to the earthly planet. The real perfection, as described in the confidential parts of the Vedas, is that one should understand who is the ultimate cause of all causes. Janmadhyasi yataha. That is explained in the Srimad Bhagavatam directly. The ultimate cause of all causes is Krishna. Even in the Bhagavad Gita, it is explained Krishna is the ultimate cause of all causes. Vasudeva sarvamiti samahatma sudurlabha. But people who are superficial knowers of the Vedas, they are attracted to such heavenly sense pleasures without knowing the real ultimate goal of life. So they come down to the earthly planet and again they may try to elevate themselves. So like this they keep revolving in the cycle of birth and death, sometimes on higher planets, sometimes in the middle planetary system, sometimes in the lower planets. But actually, if somebody takes to the ultimate goal of life to return to the spiritual world, they can enjoy eternal life full of bliss and knowledge and never return to this material world. That Krishna explains in many places in Bhagavad Gita. Yad gatva nanivartante taddhama paramam mama. Though there are different grades of planets in this universe, material world, but the supreme destination is Krishna's own planet in the spiritual world. Then Krishna says in the 24th verse, the secret, the confidential knowledge about this yajna performance, he says, Aham hi sarva yajnanam bhokta cha prabhureva cha natumam abhijananti tatvenatas chavantite. What does this mean? Krishna says, I am the only enjoyer and the only object of sacrifice. Those who do not recognize my true transcendental nature fall down. So what is the implication? All different types of yajna performances recommended in the Vedic literatures are actually meant for satisfying the Supreme Lord. Yajna means Vishnu or Krishna. Third chapter of the Bhagavad Gita clearly explained this. Yajnarthat karmanaha anyatra lokoyam karma bandhanaha tadartham karma kaunteya mukta sanga samachara. So the goal of yajna performance is to make an offering to the Supreme Lord Vishnu and try to please him by making such offerings through sacrifice. That is the real way of doing yajna. But there are so many people who think that, let me do this yajna for getting some material benefit. And they worship or they offer sacrifices to the devatas. What happens? They may get some temporary benefit, but they do not achieve the ultimate goal of freedom from material bondage. They are bound up more and more in this material world. That is why Krishna says they fall down. Fall down means they are unable to elevate themselves beyond this material existence. They remain in the material world or they are bound up more and more. So there is a very nice instructive incident described in the 10th canto of the Bhagavatam. When Krishna was present on this earth, he had incarnated, he was ruling in Dwaraka as the king of Dwaraka. And there was another king ruling from a province called Karusha. Karusha province, the king was a Kshatriya by name Paundraka. Paundraka was the king of Karusha, and he had a friend, another king, who was ruling from Kashi or Varanasi, present day Varanasi, Kashi. So the king of Kashi and the king of Karusha, Paundraka and the king of Kashi, they were very nice friends. So this Paundraka became very proud of his position. Even though he was not ruling any big province, it was a small province, and he thought that he is very, very powerful, and being very proud of his power and position, he foolishly declared himself as the supreme lord. He declared, "I am Lord Vasudeva," and he dressed himself like Vasudeva with the symbols of Shankha, Chakra, Gada, Padma, and he dressed in yellow garments, and he declared himself as the Supreme Lord, and he sent a messenger to Krishna, who was ruling in Dwaraka. He sent a messenger with the message that, he sent a messenger to Krishna that I am the real Vasudeva, you are not God, you give up your dress, your symbols, your all your position, you give up, and I have come here to deliver all distressed persons. This was the message he sent. So when this messenger went to Dwaraka and delivered to Krishna this message from Paundraka, Krishna was seated along with all his associates in the palace, and when they heard this foolish message, they all laughed. Krishna and his associates laughed very loudly, and Krishna sent back a reply, "I am the only supreme personality of Godhead. No one else is actually God." And Krishna declared to Paundraka, "You are a foolish person. I refuse to follow your instructions. I shall never give up the symbols of Vasudeva, especially my disc. I shall use this disc to kill not only you, but all your followers, who constitute a society of cheaters and the cheated." This is what the scriptures declare, especially in Kali Yuga, and even in former times, rarely of course, in former times, there used to be some cheaters, because there are people who want to get cheated. Therefore, these cheaters come forward and they are able to cheat some people, and with such false followers, foolish followers, they declare themselves as some leaders or sometimes even God. This is described by Srila Prabhupada as sometimes children, when they play among the children, one child will be selected as king, and that child will sit down on some so-called throne and declare, "I am the king and you are all my subjects." So this kind of childish play people sometimes do in real life. It is understandable children play like that. But sometimes in real life also, somebody like Paundraka, he foolishly declared himself as God. And this is with the misunderstanding that God has become God by some meditation or by some tapasya. They think if Krishna is God, Krishna has become God. What they don't understand is that God is always God. Eternally He is the Supreme Lord. God never becomes God because He is always God. Eternally He is God. And everyone else is eternally a very, very insignificant part of God. Insignificant part of God. Eternally. So this eternal position, these people don't understand. These foolish people. So they think, because they have some power, and they think they can challenge somebody else, including they try to challenge God. So this was message sent by Krishna. And then when the messenger went away, then Krishna got ready to actually finish off this false god, Paundrika. So Krishna went with a very small number of his soldiers, army, Yadu army. And when Krishna went to attack this Paundrika's kingdom, this Karusha province, then because the king of Kashi was his friend, this Paundrika was living with the king of Kashi, Krishna went and surrounded the whole city of Kashi. Then Paundrika, when he heard of Krishna's attack, he came out with two Akshauhini divisions of soldiers. And the king of Kashi came with three Akshauhini divisions of soldiers. So totally these five Akshauhini division soldiers started attacking, shower their weapons upon Krishna. So many different kinds of weapons they used to attack Krishna. And Krishna countered each of them, and finally Krishna used his Sudarshan Chakra, and he cut off the head of this Paundrika, and he also cut off the head with the Sudarshan Chakra of the king of Kashi. Then this king of Kashi, his head was thrown at the entrance gate, the big entrance gate of the city of Kashi. So everybody came to see after the battle was over. So many dead bodies were lying, and when they saw the head of the king of Kashi at the city gate, then they all began to mourn the death of the king of Kashi. So when Krishna returned to the city of Dwarka, Krishna was glorified by all the residents of the heavenly planets, the upper planets. They are singing his glories. As usual, Krishna, whenever he is able to kill such foolish persons who falsely declare themselves as God and try to imitate the position of the Lord. So the son of this king of Kashi, his name was Sudakshina, when he learned that his father was killed by Krishna, he became very, very angry at Krishna. And without knowing what is the power of Krishna, he decided that he is going to take revenge against Krishna. He decided that instead of simply going and attacking and trying to defeat Krishna, he thought, let me perform a sacrifice. And to get this support, to actually use this sacrifice to generate a powerful demon, this Sudakshina began to worship Lord Shiva. In fact, Lord Shiva is worshipped in Kashi as Vishwanatha. Even today that temple is there, very famous temple, Kashi Vishwanath temple. It's a very famous temple of Shiva, and Kashi is the specific holy place where Lord Shiva resides in the form of that deity of Vishwanatha. So the Sudakshina worshipped Lord Shiva, and Shiva was very pleased, and Shiva wanted to give a benediction. So Sudakshina sought a benediction to destroy his enemy with the help of Shiva's ghostly companions. So Shiva also directed him to perform a ritualistic sacrifice for killing one's enemy. Shiva informed Sudakshina that by properly performing this sacrifice, one very powerful personality will be generated from the sacrificial fire, who will be empowered to destroy the enemy, provided the enemy is not a qualified Brahmana. Except a qualified Brahmana, anybody else can be destroyed, whoever that enemy may be, however powerful the enemy may be. This is what Shiva informed the Sudakshina. So then Sudakshina, he actually employed some priests and began to perform the sacrifice. When the sacrifice was completed, out of the sacrificial fire came a very, very big demon whose hair, beard and mustache were exactly the color of hot copper. This form was very big and fierce. As the demon arose from the fire, there was fire emanating from the sockets of this demon's eyes. He appeared more fierce because of the movements of his eyebrows. He exhibited sharp, long teeth. He was sticking out his long tongue, licking his upper and lower lips. He was naked and he carried a big trident, Trishul, blazing like fire. Appearing from the fire of sacrifice, he stood there with his Trishul in his hand. Instigated by Sudakshina, who was performing the sacrifice, this demon proceeded towards Dwaraka. And Sudakshina directed that this demon has to attack Krishna and kill Krishna, the king of Dwaraka. So this demon was accompanied by hundreds of ghostly companions of Lord Shiva. And they appeared like they were going to burn the entire outer space to ashes. So the surface of the earth began to tremble because of the striking steps of this demon along with the ghostly companions. When they entered Dwaraka, all the residents of Dwaraka became very, 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 very afraid. What is happening? Who has come? So Krishna, when he heard from some of the residents who approached Krishna in the palace, that a fiery demon is ready to burn the whole city of Dwaraka. Please save us. And Krishna said, don't worry, I will protect you. So Krishna, what he did, he took a Sudarshan Chakra and ordered the Sudarshan Chakra to take the necessary steps to protect the city of Dwaraka, the residents of Dwaraka, and deal with this demon. So as soon as Sudarshan Chakra came in front of this demon and the ghostly companions of Shiva, the illumination of Sudarshan Chakra alone was enough to actually create fear in that demon. The demon's effulgence seemed to be very, very insignificant in front of Sudarshan Chakra's illumination. So immediately the demon was checked by Sudarshan Chakra, and the Demon, having failed to set fire to Dwarka, he had to actually use the power to actually destroy something. Since his target was unsuccessful, this is how this black magic works, that if the target is not affected, if the demon born out of the sacrificial fire is not able to destroy the target, then the demon will come back and destroy the original person who performed the sacrifice, that is Sudakshina, and Sudakshina's city also will be completely destroyed. So the demon returned to Sudakshina, and Sudakshina was burnt to ashes along with all his family members. And the Sudarshan Chakra followed this demon, also entered the city of Varanasi, which was very, very prosperous, very, very famous cities. So big, big palaces, big, big assembly houses, big, big marketplaces, large important monuments. Everything was completely burnt to ashes by Sudarshan Chakra. The whole city was destroyed because of this foolish Sudakshina trying to kill Krishna. So it is described that the real purpose of the sacrifice anybody performs is never such black magic or trying to destroy somebody. Like in the Bhagavatam, it was also described how Tvashta performed a sacrifice to take revenge against Indra, and something totally different happened because of some mistake. Similarly, the Sudakshina, without realizing that if the demon generated on the sacrifice fails to strike the target, then the demon is going to come back and kill the performer of the sacrifice himself. That the Sudakshina did not understand or did not know or did not realize. So the lesson to be learnt is that ultimately these sacrifices are never meant for anything material. If at all somebody is a pious person, then he may try to get some material benefit in a pious way by performing some sacrifices. But very soon, such a pious person should realize that the sacrifice can offer something much, much more valuable. In fact, everything described in the Vedas, not only sacrifice, any of the types of worship, any type of austerity, any type of pious activity like giving charity, all of these different procedures described in the Vedas as pious activities are ultimately meant for self-realization, are meant for ultimate liberation from material bondage. That is the real goal of all these Vedic procedures, Vedic recommendations. But because people are so much desirous of enjoying in this world, and they are always trying to make some adjustment somehow with some misunderstanding. What is the misunderstanding? That people some many times think and the body, and with as long as this body is there, let me try to enjoy life, because they think when the body is finished, everything is finished. But even if they come to know, I am not this body, I am spirit soul, they think, oh, I am not going to die at the time of death, then let me elevate myself in my next life to the heavenly planets. Let me enjoy on the heavenly planets. There is a longer duration of life and there are better facilities for enjoyment. In this way, they try to elevate themselves. How far can they elevate themselves? Even if they go on elevating themselves to higher and higher and higher and higher planets, ultimately they come to Brahmaloka. But even in Brahmaloka, if they don't practice Krishna consciousness, then at the end of Brahma's life, they fail to attain the kingdom of Krishna, kingdom of God. They fail to go to the spiritual world. They come back again to this material world and they take birth again. Even if they elevate themselves to Brahmaloka, they have to actually prepare themselves to actually enter into the spiritual world by becoming devotees. If they don't become devotees, if they don't practice devotional service, then there is no possibility of liberation, ultimate liberation. So the real purpose of sacrifice or any Vedic recommendation is ultimate liberation from material bondage. This has to be understood. So some questions I have from yesterday. If one is unattached to the fruits of material duty, like working in job or taking care of family, at the same time one has to do one's duty, how can one be motivated to do such material duties without being attached to the fruits? Good question. So the motivation for doing any work generally is the result which people think I can enjoy after performing some work. But if the result itself, as described in the Bhagavad Gita, somebody tries to be detached from the results, then what is the motivation to work? We should understand that the results are definitely meant for not oneself, but are meant for the Supreme Lord. The results of the work or the duty one performs actually belong to Krishna. So they should be offered to Krishna after performing the duty of after performing some work. So having the motivation to do the work so as to get nice results is not wrong in itself, because that can be a good motivation, that I want to do this work nicely so that I get good results. But the results should be offered to Krishna. So in order to offer the results to Krishna, if somebody is motivated to work very nicely to get good results, then that is not considered as something which is binding, that is not leading to bondage, that is not leading to material bondage, that will be liberating. So you can have the fruit of the work as the motivating factor, but only thing is, detach from the fruits or results of the work means to actually offer the results to Krishna. That is the meaning. It doesn't mean that whatever be the result, they are simply discarded or thrown away or just neglected. No. Results are there and the results have to be offered to Krishna. That is what the Bhagavad Gita is teaching us. Then the next question. At the time of death, if one attains mukti or attains the service of the Lord's lotus feet, his or her seven generations prior and seven generations to come would attain mukti also? No, it is not told like that. In the Bhagavatam, it is said, when Prahlad Maharaj prayed to the Supreme Lord Narasimha that, please pardon my father's sinful activities and excuse him, because out of foolishness and ignorance he did so many sinful activities. So Narasimha was very pleased to tell Prahlad, because you are a pure devotee, 21 generations before you will also be completely delivered, will also attain liberation. 21 generations before the devotee. So it is not after, it is before. 21 generations. If somebody attains Krishna's lotus feet or becomes completely liberated due to practicing devotional service, then 21 generations before the person who has become the devotee, who has attained liberation, will also get liberated. Now this liberation also has to be understood very carefully. What is the meaning of liberation? Now Srila Prabhupada explains that liberation in terms of becoming delivered means one is completely purified of all sinful reactions. All sinful reactions one is purified. But after such purification of the reactions, every person is able to choose where he or she wants to go, where the person wants to go. Just like those who don't have information about the spiritual world, then it is very obvious that they will choose some material destination. They may choose to take birth again in some heavenly planet, or they may take birth on the earth itself in a nice family, whatever. Wherever they want to go, they can go. But those without knowledge of the spiritual world, they cannot choose to actually go to the spiritual world, because they don't know about the spiritual world. So how can they go to the spiritual world? It's not possible. So this liberation means they are freed of all reactions and they can choose their destination. Now choosing the destination depends on their knowledge of the destination. Just like some people don't even know about this heavenly planets. So they can choose to take birth again on the earth only, that's all. They don't know of other planets and they take birth again on the earth. So foolishly, they are getting stuck up in the cycle of birth and death. They are not able to get out of the cycle of birth and death because of their ignorance. Okay, one more question I have here. What is the difference between sacrifice and charity? Giving some portion, of my earning for Krishna's service, is it sacrifice or charity? Okay, first part of the question, what is the difference between sacrifice and charity? These are two different Vedic recommendations for performing pious activities, punya karma. Sacrifice is called yajna and charity is called dana. Please keep the question. Charity is called dana, yajna and dana. So yajna specifically means a particular procedure where either in the form of a fire sacrifice, or there are other types of sacrifice also. Just like chanting the holy names of Krishna is also a sacrifice, japa yajna. So this kind of sacrifice can be done in two different ways. Either it is called sakama. Sakama means with some aim of getting some material benefit. Or nishkama, where one doesn't desire anything material but instead wants ultimate liberation from material bondage. So that is nishkama, no material desires, no material benefit is desired. Similarly, dana also, one gives dana. Dana means giving something of value to the person who is qualified to receive this dana. So the scriptures instruct a qualified brahmana or a vaishnava is to be given charity. So when somebody gives a portion of their earning for Krishna's service, it is actually devotional service. It is definitely considered as dana, but it is not merely dana, it is actually devotional service. And such devotional service ultimately qualifies the giver of such charity to Krishna, qualifies the person to actually develop pure devotion to Krishna and go back to Krishna. So we'll stop here. Thank you. Hare Krishna.